Right. So thank you, everyone. Good evening. So today the topic is actually Azure SQL. Azure SQL. The reason is, as a Azure data engineer, in real-time projects, so the destination, either Azure SQL or Azure Synapse, definitely. Either Azure SQL, Azure Synapse. Majority of the projects, the destinations related to the Azure point of view, these two things actually play the important role into the destination point of view. Azure SQL, it is one of the RDBMS concept, the relational database management system, okay? And Azure Synapse is a data warehouse. The relational database management system is different, data warehouse is different, okay? So 100% real-time projects, so most of the majority of the people are preferring these two things only, Azure SQL and Azure Synapse. Today, I'm gonna take the Azure SQL. The reason is, so tomorrow I'm planning to start the full load concept, guys. Full load, okay? In real time, when you are working with the Azure Data Engineer project, we are going to perform two loads. One is full load, second one is incremental load. Then what is full load? What is incremental load? So we have a sources. The sources may be file system in the form of CSV, Parquet, JSON, AVR or something, or else any structured data, or else any real-time streaming data, or any vendor-related data, okay? At the beginning of our project, at the beginning of real-time projects, if your source system having the data, so if you are planning to move the as-is data from source to the destination, here we are going to implement the very first load is full load. Full load means whatever the source system having the data, the data as it is, we are loading the data into destination. Either if you want in middle, you can perform some transformations. We can load that good data into destination. That is one-time activity. Full load is one-time activity in every real-time projects. Full load is the one-time activity. Okay, for example, my source system is SQL. My SQL having the 100 tables. So today, successfully, we move these 100 tables from source to the destination, either Azure SQL or a Synapse. In tomorrow, in my source system, few more tables added into the my source system. Our 100 tables are adding few more new records or few more updated records. So here, the new tables or new records or updated records, right? Those records we need to take care of from the source to the destination. We don't want to process the existing tables. Our main intention is, already yesterday, we already processed the data. Tables, there is 100 tables which is available in source system. Successfully, we are moved the 100 tables from source to the destination. In today, the 100 tables having the new data, or as this 100 tables having a few more updated records. Okay, we need to take care of only this updated data and new records from the source table to the destination, not existing data. Okay, that type of data movement we can call it as an incremental load or a delta load. Okay, as a data engineer, at the very first beginning of our project, we are going to perform the full load concept. Once if you perform the full load concept from source to the destination, if your source system again producing the any new data or any updated data, right? As a data engineer, we need to take care of only new data, updated data from the source system to the destination. That process we can call it as an incremental load. Full load is one-time activity. Incremental load is our day-to-day responsibility. Okay? As a data engineer, every day we are expecting the new data from the source system. That new data or updated data, we need to move from source to the destination. That type of data movement, we can call it as an incremental loading or delta loading. Incremental loading, delta loading. Full load is one-time activity. Incremental loading is every day we are going to perform. Okay, right. So the very important first topic is full load. Full load. Okay, here I'm going to implement this full load concept by using Azure Data Factory. By using Azure Data Factory. Okay, so already I told you, right, this is our project flow for Azure Data Engineer. Okay, here my source is Azure SQL, guys. Here my source is, SQL Server. Here, my source is Azure SQL Server. Consider Azure SQL. Okay. So, my Azure SQL having, for example, 100 tables. 100 tables. I want to move these 100 tables from source to the storage account, Azure Data Legend. Before loading the data into my destination, either Synapse or any something, right? I want to load the data into my staging layer, that is Azure Data Legend, storage account. Staging layer is storage account. While creating the storage account, we are going to select the Azure Data Legend for storing the large volume of data. The reason is my source having the data. I don't want to directly load the data into destination because my source data having the duplicate values, null values, some schema mismatching, something. Okay. Before loading the data into our destination, first we are going to load the data into storage account, right? On top of that data, we are going to perform some data cleaning and data enrichments, all those things, like preparing a good data, removing the null values, checking the duplicates or not, which is available or not, preparing the own schema. Such type of things we need to perform in middle. So finally, we'll prepare the good data, and that good data we are loading into the final destination. Okay, so for achieving this this flow, right, project flow, here my source consider, for example, maybe on-prem your wish, but here we don't have an on-prem setup, right? That is the reason here I'm taking this source as a Azure SQL. Normal SQL Server, Azure SQL Server, inside the way of options is same, but there is a difference between compute and storage and auto-scaling features. Remaining, all the concepts are same, creating databases, creating tables, right, select statement, insert statement, update statements, joining the tables, all the Windows functions, common table expressions, all are same. Okay, so here my source is Azure SQL. Here I'm going to maintain some bulk of tables, either 4 tables or 40 tables or 400 tables. So we need to load these tables from source to the staging layer, that is storage account, Azure Data Legend. Okay, for moving this data from source to the storage account, here I'm going to use the ETL process. The ETL process. So which ETL concept? Azure Data Factory. Azure Data Factory is a ETL tool. ETL means extract, transform, and load. So source, we are going to connect the source system, extract the data, and load the data into storage account. I'm not going to perform any transformations. Okay? If you want, you can perform it. So we are going to connect the source system, extract the data, and load the data into storage account under the branch container by using Azure Data Factory. Here our source is Azure SQL, right? Then here you need to know about SQL basics, SQL, structured query language. You need to know about the Azure SQL basics. Okay? So, right. Right. 1 minute, guys. Right, Azure SQL, right? Azure SQL, it is completely related to the Azure SQL only. Normal SQL, the difference between normal SQL Server and Azure SQL is both are related to the Microsoft products only. Both are related to the Microsoft product, right? Few years back, I think more than 10 or 20 years back, Microsoft introducing this SQL Server, SQL. Okay, so SQL is one of the RDBMS concept. RDBMS means Relational Database Management System. Okay, so by using this Relational Database Management System, these companies, IT sector related companies, right, whatever they having the data, like application related data, maybe front-end Java or a .NET or a PHP or a Python, anything. Right, application related data they are going to store into the databases. Okay, so in the databases we have a tables. So table means it having the rows and columns, right? It having the data. So there is a relation between one table to the another table. So by using this SQL structure query language syntax, SQL structure query language syntax, we are going to retrieve the data from the tables, from the databases. Okay, so SQL is one of the Microsoft product. Azure SQL also one of the Microsoft product. So SQL actually, which is there into the on-prem Windows machine. Azure SQL completely into the Microsoft Azure portal itself only. Azure SQL completely into the Microsoft portal itself only. Normal SQL Server, which is installed into the your on-prem Windows machines or else even a personal laptop. But Azure SQL, no need to install any software into your personal system. So we are going to do the all the structure process into the portal itself only. Okay, SQL structure query languages. Okay, so we in market we have a different types of RDBMS tools available in the market. RDBMS, relational database management system. Database, here we have a database, the database having the tables, each and every table having the rows and columns manner. Each and every table we are going to store the data in. Okay, right, there is a relation between one table to the another table. By using SQL structure query language syntax, we are going to retrieve the data from the multiple tables, inserting the data, updating the data, deleting data. So such type of things which are going to perform by using this SQL. So we have a n number of RDBMS tools available in the market. So SQL, one of the RDBMS, it is a Microsoft SQL Server only. Azure SQL, it is also one of the RDBMS concept related to the Microsoft. Oracle, MySQL, Postgres SQL, IBM DB2, MariaDB, right? So we have a n number of RDBMS techniques which is available in the market, right? So each and every domain like a healthcare or a banking or enterprise or e-commerce, right? So all these domains related applications generally, whatever they are doing the business, right? The data, they are going to store in the form of databases only. Okay, databases, right? So, right, here I'm going to create the Azure SQL. Normal SQL Server, we have also, which is provided by the Microsoft product only, but there is a limitation, guys. But there is a limitation. But Azure SQL, they are providing lot of features. Okay, see, while creating the Azure SQL, here we have three types of modes available. So based upon the project requirement, you can select based upon the project need and cost and building, and based upon the different factors, we are going to consider these options. Unnecessarily, blindly, we are not going to select anything. So before beginning of the project, based upon the data size, we need to select these options. And there is a documentation is there. So we are going to specify all the naming conventions, cost, compute, storage, everything, options, sub-options, everything we are going to specify under the document. We are send the document into the client. So once if you got the approval from the client, right, based upon these calculations and factors and cost, so we are going to implement these things. And here I'm going to create the Azure SQL, but in real time, this DevOps team or Azure DevOps team, by using this infrastructure as a code tool like a Terraform ARM templates, they are going to create these resources. As a data engineer, inside Azure SQL, our responsibility. Inside Data Factory, our responsibility. Inside Databricks, inside Azure Synapse, our responsibility. Okay, right. So the topic is full load. As a data engineer, we need to move the data from source to the destination. Okay, two types of load, full load and incremental load. Here my source is Azure SQL. My destination is storage account Azure Data Lake Gen 2. I want to copy the bulk of tables from the source to the Azure Data Lake Gen 2. Right? While moving this data from source to the Azure Data Lake Gen 2. Right? So here we are using the Azure Data Factory as a ETL tool. For achieving this mechanism, data movements from source to the storage account by using this Azure Data Factory, so here I'm going to cover the multiple scenarios. Each and every scenario, you can treat as a one user stories. When you're working with the sprint-based methodology under the scrum-based process, right? You can treat as a one scenario as a one user story. Right? Scenarios are how to copy multiple tables from Azure SQL database to Azure Data Lake Gen 2. So here source is a Azure SQL. Azure SQL having the 100 tables, right? How to copy these 100 tables from source to your destination? That is first scenario. Second scenario, how to avoid running copy activity if table not available in the source site? Okay, So in Azure Data Factory, we have one activity. The activity name is called copy activity. By using this copy activity, we are copying the data from source to the destination. Okay. For example, in my source side, I have 100 tables. So while copying the 100 tables from source to the storage account, unfortunately, 95 tables are present under the source system. 5 tables are not present under the source system. Due to some reasons, the source system just delete the 5 tables or just decommission the 5 tables. When we are copying these 100 tables from source system to the storage account, definitely our pipeline is going to fail, right? This copy activity is going to copy the 95 tables, but 5 tables are not present under the source system. Definitely our Azure Data Factory pipeline is going to fail, right? If any tables are not present under the source system, then how we are going to handle that situation? Very, very important. That is second scenario. And third scenario, how to create and maintain metadata table? Very, very important. This metadata table is going to play the important role while working with the full load and incremental load. Full load and incremental load. Metadata maintaining the main important and key role play. Okay, right. Here we are talking about Azure SQL. Here we are talking about SQL, right? SQL. Right. For example, you know, right, every book having the index page. At the very first beginning, if you open the book, the very first page, right, we can able to see the index page. The purpose of the index page is the index page having the all the chapters, right, and the page numbers as well. So by using this index page, so based upon user need, so he just opened the index page and based upon his interest, he can just see the page number with respect to the chapter. I can easily open that chapter, either chapter 3 or chapter 5. So index page is going to help to find out the things easy manner, right? So same like, I have it 100 tables which is available in my source system. All this 100 tables information which is available under the metadata table. All this source related tables information which is available under the metadata table. Out of 100 tables, there is a 101 table is there. The 101 table name is called metadata table. This metadata table having the all the 100 tables information. Each and every table schema name, each and every table name, whether this table is available from the source side or not. If available, we can make it as a 1. If not available, we can make it as a 0. Right? So, even though we can maintain the timestamp, for example, there is employee table, few records are inserted employee table today's particular time. I want to maintain the timestamp into the all the metadata tables. Each and every table timestamp I want to maintain under the metadata table. So such type of things I want to maintain it under the metadata table. So metadata table is going to play the very important role while you are handling the structured data. Okay, then how we are going to create this metadata table and how we are going to maintain here. That is third scenario. Fourth scenario, right? Here we are going to create the pipeline. The pipeline having the Azure Data Factory pipeline, that pipeline having the activities. Okay. Pipeline is going to connect the source system and extracting the data and load the data into storage account under the Azure Data Lake Gentoo. Right. So maybe every day, our pipeline is going to fail mode or else success mode. These two factors. Definitely our pipeline is going to either fail mode or a success mode. If in case my pipeline is going to success, I want to get the alert through my email. In case my pipeline is going to fail, I want to get the alerts through the email. Because in real time, no one is going to waste the time to intentionally monitoring these pipelines. Right, maybe some pipelines taking the 5 minutes time to consume the data from source to the destination. Some based upon the data size, pipeline is going to complete. Right, today actually we are copying the data 1 GB of data. Tomorrow just 500 MB of data. Today it will take only maybe 30 minutes time. Tomorrow maybe it will take 15 minutes or something. Okay, so we don't know exactly, but no one is going to intentionally monitoring the pipelines and all. Because everyone developer having their own work. I want to get through alerts only. Emails, everyone can able to check it. Automatically, there is a pop-up will be comes to our system. So we can easily check our pipeline notifications. okay, whether our pipeline is going to fail mode or a success mode, I want to get the alerts through the Outlook or a Gmail. Okay, right. Send a notification using the logic apps on both failures and success scenarios of pipeline. For achieving this mechanism, here I'm going to use the logic apps concept. Logic apps service. In Azure portal, there is one service called logic apps. By using this logic apps, okay, we can specify the HTTP notifications whenever our pipeline is going to fail or is successful. So these four scenarios, I'm going to show you into the full load concept. All right. For achieving these things, first you need to know about the SQL basics, Azure SQL. Here I'm going to explain the Azure SQL. It is one of the relational database management system. All right. Any questions so far? Please let me know.
In the second point, so out of our running copy activity in this case, so I did understand like this, like so the process actually got the data from the meta table and it got the count of 100 of tables count. So when it started copying the data from the source to the storage account, meanwhile, so can I assume that somebody got somebody deleted the tables from the source? Is it the way that I could understand?
Sorry, I missed it. Can you please repeat the question one more time?
So how to avoid running copy activity? So so what I understood is, so the process actually read metadata and the data table count is to 100. So it started copying data from source and loading that into storage account. So during this process, somebody deleted or deletes the tables from the source. So is that the scenario that is
no.
talking? Okay.
No, no.
So
let me tell you.
Okay.
Let me tell you. So generally, we have a source system. Source. This source is completely maintained by the separate team, okay? Right. Consider your source is on-prem. Source is on-prem. You are using SQL Server. Here we have a 100 tables. Consider 100 tables. This 100 tables information which is available in metadata. Okay? Right. Right. By using this Azure Data Factory, first we are going to connect with the source system. Right. Next, final agenda is we need to load the data into our destination. Can you please mute from your end? So destination may be either Azure SQL or a Synapse Service. Okay. Due to some reasons, source system side, maybe here we have a 100 tables. Here we have a 100 tables. Okay. 100 tables information which is present under the metadata. Like here we have a one of the column is there. The column name is called is active. Okay. For example, employee table is available. Yes, we can make it as one. Department table is available. Yes. Order table is available. Yes. Sales table is available. There is a one more table that is a test table. Okay. Due to some project requirement, this table actually, there is no scope. There is no scope for this table. And since so many months onwards, so we are not using this table. Okay. So, on that time situation, the source system is going to delete this data, delete these tables. Okay. If the table is no longer available in source system, right? So immediately they are going to write one update query. They are going to update this metadata table. If the temporary table, for example, test to table. Okay. If there is no usage for this test to table under the source system. Okay, immediately they are going to write one update query and make it as a zero because this table actually there is no longer use. Okay. All right. So that is the things which we need to do it under the metadata table. Right. See, here tables available information, we can make it as a 1. If the table is not available, we just make it as a 0. But here, a copy activity, the intention is copying the all the tables. But unfortunately, metadata table having the all the table information. Okay, fine. But here, 0, right? Means table is not present. If it is not present, definitely our pipeline is going to run. So in ADF, first we are going to call the metadata into the our ADF pipeline. This ADF is going to pick the all the 100 tables from the source system. But here we have a 99 tables. But we are calling the metadata. But we are calling the metadata. Metadata is going to call the 100 tables. But one of the table is not present. But that information which is present under the metadata table. 99 tables are available, make it as a 1. One table is not available, we make it as a 0. Right? If you are using Azure Data Factory pipeline, in this situation, if any table is not present, right? In Azure Data Factory, there is a one activity called get metadata activity. So by using this activity is going to check how many tables are existing, how many tables are not existing. So this get metadata is going to check if the tables is existing, right? Only existing tables information, it is going to copy it and take the and pass this information into the other activity, means copy activity. This copy activity is going to copy only available table information, not remaining. So here, there is a one condition is coming to the ADF, that is a if activity, if we have a true and a false. Okay, under true, we have a copy activity. False, we have a wait activity. Copy, before that, we have a get metadata activity. Get metadata going to check whether this tables is existing or not. Only existing tables information get metadata is going to give to the copy activity under true. If remaining tables are not present under the source system, right, that information is going to take the get metadata activity and pass into the false activity. This false activity is going to hold the some period of time, means false activity having the wait activity. False, under the false, we have a wait activity. Wait means it is going to hold the particular time. For example, here I just specify the duration is 60 minutes. In between 60 minutes, copy activity is going to copy the 99 tables. Okay, automatically this activity is going to skip. Then no need to worry about this one, because main intention is we need only available table information. This false is going to hold the some specific duration only. Is it clear?
Yeah, so it's clear.
Others, any questions?
Hi, student.
Yeah,
here, this is my understanding. Just in metadata will hold all the 100 tables information using the ADF. Here we have get metadata, which is going to check the available whether the table is exist or not. Based on that, we are using the if something, some if condition or something like that, where it confirms if the table is exist, we will continue. That means copy your activity. If it is false, we will wait for few, so whatever it is, for a few duration, and then that table will not get copied, or will it copy?
Not copied. Our main intention is available tables, we need to copy it. Remaining things, we just hold some specific period of time only. After that, if we have entire data is copied from source to destination, right? Automatically, this option is going to ignore, skip.
Then in that case, our initially our metadata table is saying we have 100 tables. But here, coming to our ADF, we did not copy all. But that means we missed one. Will the condition pass? I mean,
pass. Pass. Finally, as a data engineer, we need to copy the available tables only. So make sure our pipeline 100% going to success mode.
Okay.
So that is the way we need to implement the logic.
Okay.
Sir, we'll be seeing this practically, right? Because that time it will be very much clear. Because something we are just discussing more theoretically, so a lot of questions will come.
Correct.
If you see something practically, then all things will fall in place.
Definitely. For doing the lab, it will take 2.5 hours time to implement this section, these things. Okay. Because here we are discussing the multiple scenarios. Okay?
Yeah.
Right. Any other questions, others?
And metadata is like static insert, right?
metadata table?
No, no.
How that metadata table will be loaded? Like how 100 tables are there initially? Are we
We need to
inserting?
prepare it. Metadata table, our responsibility, our source team responsibility to maintain it. We need to create a normal metadata table, and we need to pass the insert statement, schema name table. I will show you later tomorrow.
Okay.
Fine. Yeah, Kasim.
Yeah, Shravan. So this get metadata activity, it collects table information from metadata, whichever the they maintain from the source side.
No, before here, I'm going to add the multiple activities. Okay. So see, tomorrow you will get the clear picture. Okay. The very first one is lookup activity to know about the metadata information. Next, I'm going to take the for each activity because bulk of tables we need to take care of, right? From source to target.
Okay.
For each going to iterate the multiple tables one by one. For loop and for each, I don't know. I think you guys are know. I don't know. I'm not sure. But tomorrow I will explain for and for each difference. Right, inside for each get metadata and activity if factory. There are a lot of activities I'm gonna add it here. Okay. I will show you this lab by tomorrow.
Okay.
Right. Okay, let me jump into the Azure SQL. So here, for example, last option, SQL virtual machines. Right. I want to maintain this my databases into the my own on-premises machines. I want to create one machine, Windows machine. Inside machine, I want to install SQL Server 2000 software. All right, I want to install something databases and maintain the tables. And if you want, you can maintain own your on-premises environment manner. Yes, you can select this option. So it is a high availability. High availability. I hope you guys are aware of high availability. Redundancy options, LRS, GRS, ZRS. Okay, right. So instance manner also is there. But I will show you, because here I'm using the free trial, let me take the single database only. I will explain this elastic pool, multiple mesh, multiple databases. Right, single database, I'm going to create it here. Create. Right, scroll down. Resource group. Right, while creating the SQL databases, here we have options, basics, networking, security, additional settings, stacks, and review create. Fine. Okay, it will this creations will be taken by the DevOps team. Okay, right. While creating this SQL database, let me pass the mandatory information, resource group name, database name, server. I hope you guys are familiar about this server. Server means anyone. Can you please let me know the difference between server and database? Is server having a database or a database having a server?
No, server having the database.
Then what is server?
Server is a tool like we can connect the SQL server.
No, not exactly.
The location where our database is located.
Is server contain only databases? You know how many servers are available in the market? Before that, what is server?
Connecting to one server to
basically, server is a machine where which will provide many services to the user.
Yes, correct. So you guys are able to see my machine, right? Laptop. You can just treat as a one server. I can do anything here. We are not going to store any SQL data here. So we can do anything here. We can install the softwares. We can do our process, all those things. Server also having some compute and storage. Means RAM, memory, hard disk, processor, everything here. Same like a laptop, Windows laptop or Linux machine, right? Those machines having the compute and storages. Here also server having the compute and storage. Can you please let me know, guys, how many types of servers available in the market?
Microsoft SQL Server, Oracle, DB2. These are servers only, right?
So you're talking about only databases. Remaining?
Linux and Windows.
Mainframes.
Those are... Okay, fine. Not... So, very good. Application servers, file servers, web servers. So, there are different types of servers available in the market. Yes. Okay. All right. So, we'll discuss these basics in tomorrow, 4 to 5 in the IT sessions. Okay. All right. Here, I'm going to create server first. Server name is full load. Here we are doing the full load part. Right. I'm going to maintain the entire lab into the West2S. If you have any questions, just at least any basics, just note it down and you can ask me the questions in tomorrow 4 to 5 year timing. Okay. If anyone new to the IT industry, right, please note down this all these options, names and all. You can raise these things in by tomorrow. I will explain in detail with example. All right. West2S2. Let me select the while creating the SQL Server databases. Here we have a different types of authentication. Correct. I, for example, I'm using my personal laptop. Only I'm the one who wants to use my laptop only, not others. So I can maintain some passwords and all, right? So username and password. So here we have a authentication techniques like Microsoft Entra, use SQL and Microsoft Entra, and plain SQL authentication. So Microsoft Entra means like Active Directory. So in Active Directory, we have a groups, dev group, QA group, data engineer group, data science group, dev, admin group. So these, each and every group having the users, like developers or DevOps or something persons, right? Who are part of your project, Microsoft Entra authentication, Microsoft Entra. If you want to access this server into the your project team, right, who are part of your Microsoft Entra Active Directory, so those people can able to access it. And here I have a SQL team is also there, and I have a, my project team is also there. I want to connect these both teams to wants to connect this my SQL database. Yes, you can give this option. No, so here I just select the SQL authentication only. Who are having the right username and password, admin related thing, person, right? Only those people can able to access my database. So based upon our need, project need, here we are going to select these options. Okay, let me create one username and password here. And let me pass the confirm password as well. Right, click on OK. If you click on OK, it will go back to the previous step. Right, server is created. Database name is testdb. Okay, so server having the database. I don't want elastic pool. I will explain this elastic pool concept later. Workload environment, either development or production. Development and production. I want to do my things first in dev environment. If everything is going good, I will go into the production manner. But dev compute storage is different. Production compute storage is different, guys. Here I'm going. So while create, I know, I think you guys are aware of it, right? Compute and storage. Compute means, for example, I'm using my personal laptop. My like configurations are i7 processor, 8 GB RAM, 1 TB hard disk. Like the way I have a configurations, right? So we have a hard disk also, HDD, right? So based upon your hard disk, right? You are based upon hard disk configurations, you can store the data, right? So here we have a compute and storage. If you want more configurations and more compute, more storage, you can select this option. But if you are using Azure SQL free trial, if you are using Microsoft Azure portal as a free trial, right? You can keep it this option as it is, don't change. If you change these configurations, if you are using free Microsoft Azure portal, if you change this option while creating the Azure SQL, definitely it will throw the error. These are all the default settings for Microsoft Azure free trial with respect to the SQL. Please don't change these options if you are using free trial. If you are using pay-as-you-go method, I don't want to worry about cost. I need more compute, right? You can increase the options here, right? How much cores you want, max cores, minimum cores, right? How much memory you want, right? Like the way you can just select it here. So based upon your selection, the cost may be vary. If you use the provision, right, they are going to charge you 3,000 rupees per month. If I select the serverless option, they are going to charge the 398 rupees per month. So provision means they are going to charge the hour manner. So serverless means they are going to charge this option as a second manner. Okay. For example, if you select this option, if you just create Azure SQL after half an hour, right, if you just deleted, right, but they are charging the amount hour manner, whether it does not matter. before 1 hour or after 1 hour, they are going to treat as a hour manner. Less than 60 minutes, they can treat as a hour based charges. After 60 minutes, they are going to charge the one more extra hour. So that is the reason cost may be varying. Okay. So these are hardware configurations. Same laptop having the hardware configurations, right? Same hardware configurations here also. Okay. I don't want to disturb these things. Let me put it as it is. Apply. Right. One vCore is enough. 32 GB storage is enough. Because here we are doing the just POC, just practice purpose only. Here we're just learning all those things. I don't want advanced things. Just basics is enough. Okay. Right. Next, there is the option called backup storage redundancy. Anyone? Any idea about redundancy?
High availability.
High availability means we are storing the data, large volume of data or some GBs of data. Here we are going to store into the our databases. If mistakenly or intentionally, if anyone delete the data, right? Like I want to take the backups, or something is going wrong with my region. Something is going wrong with my region, right? I want to maintain the data into multiple regions. Okay, so for this reason, we have a redundancy options. Already I explained this LRS, GRS, ZRS, GZRS option at the beginning of our course. These are all the basics. If anyone new to these things, right, just to go through the basics from the drive. Still, if you have any questions, let me know by tomorrow. Here, I'm going to take the local redundant backup storage. Means one data center is coming to the picture here. Under West US, one data center is come to the picture. So whatever we are storing the data, right, that data is going to store in the three copies of data. One is original, two are duplicates. Next, click on networking. Right. Here we are using the Azure SQL. We are going to store the our project related data. I want to access my SQL database securely and privately over part of my IP address. Range of specific people can able to access my SQL database. Here we have a private endpoint. While creating the private endpoint, there is a virtual network concept is come to the picture. All right. First, we need to create a virtual network. Later, you can add it here. So there is a set of IP address range will be created here. So they who are having the who are part of that range, right? Those people can able to access your service securely and privately. Let me put it no access security. Skip these options. Next, additional settings, guys. Here we have a data source option. Here we have a use existing data. Here we have three options: none, backup, and sample. Okay. Once SQL database created, right? I want some dummy tables. I need some dummy tables to perform some SQL operations. So if you select the sample, right, there is a dummy tables will be created. If you select the none, means nothing. Only simple SQL database will be created. So you need to create the tables and data, right? If you click on backup, right? In Azure SQL, sorry, in Azure portal, we have a one of the service called vault, recovery service vault. By using this recovery service vault, we are going to do the primary and disaster recovery mechanism as well as we can do the backups as well. For example, we have a on-prem, we just take the backup from the on-prem SQL. That SQL having the schemas means we're having the table database having the tables. I want to load this as this data into my SQL database. If you take the backup by using the recovery service vault, right? So those backup you can able to see it here. This backup will be taken care by the admin thing, not data engineer. If you want to load that backup data into your SQL databases, right? Yes, we can use this one. Okay. So as of now, I'm going to select the none. Next to tags. So my SQL database actually related to maybe something Medicare project. Medicare project, there is a Java-based application. Here, the environment is dev environment. Application number is something 1234. So the purpose of tags is, if something is going wrong within my SQL database, for easily identification purpose, I have a 100 SQL servers which is installed by in Microsoft Azure portal, right? I want to know which SQL server related to the which application, which project, or which something, which application, which environment, right? So tags is going to especially help to identify the environment manner. Next to review and create. So just you can check it, the estimation cost, all those things. Storage point of view, they are going to cost the 398 rupees. Compute cost 0.02. Okay, right. Click on create. Before click on create this option, if you have any questions, let me know. Okay, click on create. So especially platform as a services, guys, PaaS services. So it will take more than 2 minutes. Because development related services, right? So it having backend lot of plugins. That is the reason it will take some time to create. So let's wait for 2 more minutes.
Yes, like, Shravan,
yeah, please.
So the storage, the cost is 398 rupees, and it stores
Correct.
The data in the database. And the
Correct.
Compute, for the compute, it is 0.012. And what actually functions are the operations are involved in compute? For this SQL, Azure SQL.
So already I told you, right? Before click on the create, if you have any options, right? Already ask this question, right? You can repeat that question by tomorrow. I will show you the
okay,
options.
Okay. For this course, right? So when we selecting the course, is it that one compute means?
So compute means we have processing, right? Storages and cost, right? Like RAM, memory, hard disk, processor. So based upon these all the factors, they are divide this cost actually. I will let you know by tomorrow this thing.
Okay, so
basically, how are you to arrive? Suppose there is a source system which is having, for example, one database and it has some 50 tables, like. So in that case, like how means. The system will show directly the cost that will be involved in the operation, or we need to basically.
Sorry, system. Can you please repeat it?
When you're trying to create a database.
Okay.
Then we will try to load the data from other system to this Azure SQL, right?
Yeah, first you need to check about the compatibility, all those things.
Okay,
first we need to prepare it, right? Before that, then only we can do the planning and assessment. First,
yeah,
we need
this
to
analysis
know
part,
about
who will be doing this analysis part, like the source system?
Source team, or else
yeah.
Ours only. For, as a data
okay.
engineer, first we need to check the our data sender.
Okay.
So sometimes if the source system is done, not is there, it's our responsibility. So they are just give the all the heads up. After that, we need to take care of everything, right? First, we need to check the all this assessments and planning, all those things, whether the data, whether how many tables are present, what are the schemas types, how much data it will be there, right? Everything we need to check it. So then only we can go and deploy this into the our destinations.
Here, is it something related to Azure administration, this part, or?
No, admin. Here we are going to do the development part after. Sometimes when we are doing the migrations, right, maybe there is a chance to migrate the data from source to destination, but it's very rare. That will be taken care by the majority admin. I think in real-time projects, admins already migrate this SQL data to the cloud environment.
Okay.
As a data engineer, inside services, our development-related parts only.
Okay.
This backups, this deployments, everything will be taken care by the admin team or a DevOps team. Okay. Right. So, the very first step is, once SQL server is created successfully, here the very first step is we need to set up the firewall. These things also will be taken by the Azure admin team, right? Set server firewall, because if you specify this firewall things, right, then only you can able to enter into the inside SQL. Okay, let me click on set server firewall. Right, here generally people are following the private access only, private endpoint, right? Who are part of specific IP address, right? Those people can able to access the Azure SQL. But here we don't have any IP address mechanism. Here I'm gonna select the public access only. Public access means anyone can able to access, right? Let me select the, even though public access also, only my system wants to connect this Azure SQL, only my system. Okay, right now I'm not working any project. Here I'm just doing some dummy practices only. Only my system says generally 100% systems having IP address, right? Okay, IP config. So we have two types of IPs, private IP and public IP, right? Private IP. Here we are able to see the private IP, right? Means only personal laptops, office laptops having the private IP address. The public IP address means if you want to do some browsing, if I want to do some Googling, right? Definitely our machine having the public IP. Definitely our machine having the private IP and public IP. So let me open the my public IP address. So each and every machine having the their own public IP address. So this is my public IP address, IPv4, IPv6. There are two types of IPs available in the market, IPv4, IPv6. Okay, copy the IPv4. So select a network, only my system wants to connect this Azure SQL. So here we have a firewall rule. Click on firewall rule. So let me specify the IP address. Same IP address, start IP address, end IP address. Because here we don't have any team. Only I am the person to do the practice in my system. Only my system wants to connect Azure SQL, not other systems. Starting IP address, ending IP address. For example, you have a range IP. Okay, something 10.0.0.0.0. Okay. So next to 10.0.0.0.9, right? Who are part of this IP address from 0 to 9 means 10 IP address. Only the 10 IP address people can able to access Azure SQL. I hope you clear, right? Who are part of this IP address, who are having the access on in between this IP address, those people can able to access this Azure SQL. Right, let me specify the same IP address only. Scroll down. Here we have an option called checkbox. Click on this one. Allow Azure services and resources to access this server. Click on save. So these details you need to pass it. But in real time, we are not going to use the public option. 100% we are going to use the private access. Or else you can use the connectivity option. Here we have inbound and outbound rules is there. That rules will be created by the admin team. All right. Any issue related to the Azure SQL for accessing, Azure Synapse related accessing, right? Feel free to reach out to admin team. They will help you for access point of view. Right. As of now, setup is ready. Setup is ready. Now it's time to connect the Azure SQL. Now it's time to connect the Azure SQL. Okay. So how many of know about the IDBMS tools, integrated development environment tools, sorry, IDE tools, IDE tools, integrated development environment tools. What is the purpose of IDE tools? How many types of IDE tools available in the market based upon technology?
For Java, we have Eclipse and Python, Python and Anaconda.
Very good. Very good. But then what is the purpose of IDE tools?
We can easily develop the code simply.
Yes, by using this IDE tool, we are going to write the respective technology code. Visual Studio related to the DevOps. .NET. Visual Studio code related to the DevOps. PyCharm related to the Python. Eclipse related to the Java. SQL Server Management Studio related to the SQL. Right? By using this IDE tool, we are writing the development. We are doing some development part. Okay? Right. As a data engineer, we are going to work with some IDE tools. One IDE tool is SQL Server Management Studio. So here we have a server name, right? Copy the server name, right? SSMS, SQL Server Management Studio. SQL Server Management Studio. By using this SSMS tool also, we can able to do it our lab. So is it mandatory to install this software into my system? I'm a new to data engineer. I have some bandwidth in my laptop. Like my RAM, my laptop is 4 GB something only. For me, it's very difficult to install the SQL Server Management Studio into my system, right? Is it a mandatory? No. Okay. So, right. So, in left side, Azure SQL, right? So they are providing each and everything. Each and everything. See, in left side, there is the option called Query Editor. Query Editor. Click on Query Editor. Here, we need to give the username and password. Username and password. Click on enter. So here also you can do your lab, but there is a UI limitation, user interface limitation, right? But in SQL Server, so we have a lengthy UI, so we can write the multiple things, we can do the output in a big picture manner. But here we have a some limitation. Here we have a some limitations, okay? Right, either using the Query Editor also we can do your SQL related labs, or else you can use the SQL Server Management Studio also we can do your lab. So just select the proper authentication method and pass the password, connect. Okay, while creating the Azure SQL, I already given my database name. My database name is testDB. So there is a default database is available into the your databases, that is master database. So I don't want to do the into the master. Let me select the my database name, that is a testDB. testDB. Okay, right. Tomorrow I will execute these scripts. Okay. Right. Let me explain the tables. How many of new to the SQL? Completely zero knowledge. Please confirm. Okay, right. Okay, right. So this is the table syntax for creating the table. Create table and a table name. So please share your details by tomorrow, guys. I will explain these basics on tomorrow, 4 to 5. Vamshi, as you mentioned, data pipelines are monitored. If any issues automatically trigger the email, what kind of monitoring tools we use Azure Data Engineering to set the monitoring tools with? So either you can use the log analytics to set the alerts, or else you can use the Azure Monitor or a log analytics. Fine. Azure Monitor and log analytics. Right. So here, this is a table syntax related to SQL. Okay. So syntax is create table name. Create table name. So while creating the tables, right, we need to pass the column names. Right. Table is having the rows and columns. Rows and columns. I have a two columns. Product ID, product table, product ID, one column. Product name, one column. So each and every column having data types. We have a data types which is available in SQL, right? RDBMS also, data variables also, programming also having the data types. Right? Java, .NET, Python also having the data types. SQLs, RDBMS technology also having the data types. So product ID means integer. I want to maintain only 1 to 9 numbers only. If is there any more than 9 something, I want to maintain some big int. So data types, restriction. Right, only here product ID must and should comes in between 1 to 9 only. Product name must and should comes under the character. Or a string. In programmatic manner, we can call it as string. Here we are calling it as a character. Or where character. Or when character. right? Product name, TV, one product, which is comes under product name, where care. Okay. Right. Next, one more table. Create table, table names. Here we are passing the column names and data types. Okay. Select, if you want, you can select entire thing, or if you want to select individual, you can execute it. Your wish. Let me copy all and execute. Okay. Right. Tables created successfully. Tables created successfully. Now, right. Let me insert the some dummy data into the tables. Okay. Right. So this is the insert statement. Okay. Tables is created. Fine. Okay. Here I'm going to write the select statement. Select statement. Select to start from product to table. Product to table. This is the schema name. Right? Each and every human having first name and last name, right? So product also having schema name. DBO. Default schema name is DBO, database object. If you have any own schema name, you can specify it before the table name. Select star from table name. Star means all columns. Star means all columns. See, here we have a product table. We have product ID and product name, right? Right? Product ID, product name. But we don't have any data. I want to insert some data into my product table. Insert into these three keywords. We need to pass it. Table name and values. Product IDs, 111, 222. Product name, laptop and mobile. I want to insert this data into product table. Let me run the product table now. Now see, data is inserted. By using this insert statement, we are going to insert the some data. Same like we have a remaining tables also is there. Let me select it. Click on execute. Okay. Right. Here I'm going to create the metadata table. Very, 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 very important. Very, very, very important. See, create same above syntax. Create table, table name and column names. Right. Same like create table, table name, metadata table. These are all column names. Generally, we have a few tables available in the source system. Those are product table, sales table, transaction table, customer table, and employee table. Already told you, right? Each and every table having schema, DBO, or any in real time, each and every table having the own schema, something TLT underscore, something TLT, something dot product. Okay. SLT dot sales. Like the way we have a separate schema names, which is present under the real time neuron. Okay, so as of now, I'm going to take the, if you are not specifying any schema right before a table, so there is a default schema will be created, that is DBO, that is DBO, right, that is DBO, okay, fine, okay, right, so, right, see, here I'm going to create a metadata table. Metadata table means, metadata table having the, all this table information, okay, every table having the own schema, right. Every table having some columns, right? Okay. Like schema name. I want to maintain schema name. Table name. Right? Table name, product to table name, employee table name, order table name. Right. Next, blob container. I will explain this column tomorrow. Means the reason is here we are copying the data. Here we are copying the tables. Where we are copying these tables? From Azure SQL. Then where we are loading the data? Under the storage account, under the branch container. Container means it is a drive, right? C drive something. Inside the drive, I want to maintain some folder structure. Means product one folder. Inside product folder, product whatever this product having the data, that data I want to maintain inside product table in the form of CSV parquet into like a under Azure Data Lake general. I want to maintain destination format, something CSV. Okay. This structured data, right? Data I want to maintain into the storage account. Can you please mute from your end, Anuradha? Right. While copying the data from source table into the storage account under the branch container, I want to maintain the form of CSV format. Okay. Each and every table I want to maintain under the branch as a folder manner. Means product one table, sales one table, transaction one table, customer one table. Means folder or a table or a directory, whatever. Product one folder under the branch container. Inside folder, I want to maintain the data in the CSV format. Okay, so I want to maintain my own naming convention. If I successfully move the data from source to staging layer, right, Azure Data Lake Gen 2. So here, source table is, here source table is product table. No, source table is product table. Okay, fine. In destination, I want to maintain my table name, folder name is product output. Automatically, I want to maintain my own naming convention. Once the data is copied successfully from Azure SQL to the storage account, right? I want to maintain, instead of product table, I want to maintain my own naming convention, that is product output. Sales, I want to maintain sales output. Like the way I want to maintain my own naming convention. Yes, it is possible. If you want to maintain, once the data is successfully from source to the destination, right? In destination, I want to maintain my own naming convention. Yes, it is possible. So in the metadata table, you can specify this here. Next two, one more column, is disabled. Is disabled, right? If the product table is available, we can make it as a zero, means available. Opposite, either if you want all available, you can make it as a one. If the table is only not available, you can make it as zero. Maybe some of the projects are taking the vice versa. If the table is available, yes, they are making it as a zero. If the table is not available, we can make it as a one, your wish, vice versa. As of now, here we have a product sales transaction customer EMP table is there. But even though metadata table having the product sales transaction customer EMP, but there is a one table order table which is not present. But metadata table having the order table information. We just updated the make it as a one because 1 hour back, we just source team delete the order table and update this information into the one. Means zeros means tables are available. Metadata having the all the table information. Whether table is present or whether table is not present. I hope you understand about the metadata table right now. So this is the main, this is the things which we need to implement it by tomorrow. Okay, let me execute it successful. And let me execute the metadata statement successful. Okay, remove it, right? Select, select is a statement to filter the data. Star means you can get the all columns from metadata table, pass the schema name, 100% we need to pass the schema name. Execute. See? Right, schema name, table name, blob container is disabled. We successfully insert some data into the metadata table. Now metadata table having the all the table information on it. So we are calling this metadata table into the our Azure Data Factory pipeline. So this metadata is going to take the all the tables from the source system, including tables present or not. Is it clear? If you have any questions, let me know. Can you please confirm at least yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Clear, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Are we good to go with the next things? Or if you have any questions related to the basics, let me know, guys.
Sir, I have not installed this Azure at my end. Is it, can I start it now?
No need, Andy. So let's wait for a few more days. Once we are entered into the practical, right, just you can create Azure portal from your end. While creating the Azure portal, if you face any issues, you can reach out to me. Or else you can share your screen in session before beginning of the session or after the session. I will help you.
Okay.
Right, this is a part related to the SQL. So I will explain these Windows functions later, like Windows functions, common table expressions, and stored procedure. I will explain later. Okay. Right. Later means tomorrow I will explain it. So tomorrow I'm gonna start the this full load concept. Okay. So we'll do these scenarios. So this is our design actually. Okay. I think I need to update this design. Right. So I think you guys are familiar about the Azure Data Factory, right? In Azure Data Factory, what are the important components available? Anyone? So if you want, you can check these things, guys. So a few minutes back, I have created some tables, right? Same test DB. So you can able to see those things here also. Refresh it. Expand the tables. See? Customer, EMP, metadata, product, sales, transactions. Right, either you can do here it as well, here it as well. If you do the here, right, it will reflect it to here it as well. Then like start from DBO dot customer table. Okay, but UIZ, somewhat UI is not compatible, is not comfortable to do the our labs actually. So ID tools are